Next, we have Matthew Fisher. Matthew was a big hit last year. He is one of the last remaining foreign correspondents that Canada actually has out there in the world. And he's one of the few who speaks a different kind of truth from the kind that you may find on the CBC.
Yeah, on the CBC, yes. I could give a whole talk about how CBC covers the world, but I won't today. I have a small video that I want to show you. Now, the fact is, as a journalist, you don't just go out if you work for a newspaper to do the reporting. You also have to shoot video with iPhones and produce these mini videos that they put up on the web. So they are not that professional, but I think they sometimes speak to some terrible problems. And some of the themes that were discussed here today are, there was no collaboration between Moses and I about what the agenda would be or what people would talk about here, but so many of the themes have touched on what I've done in the past year. And one of those themes was, I spent time with the Yazidis in Iraq in December, and it was the most harrowing interview I've ever done in my life was there. That interview was not for video because the woman was in no shape to give an interview, but there is a small video which I hope you'll play of a psychiatric nurse who worked with this woman and with others, and then I'll talk a bit about her very sad tale.
These are the ruins of the town of Sinjar, which was recently liberated from Islamic State. It includes a mass grave where human bones are visible, as well as a warren of tunnels that were used to avoid coalition airstrikes. For a ghastly bounty of $20,000 paid by her family, this woman from Sinjar and her two sons were freed from Islamic State after more than a year in captivity. Her husband was probably murdered. Her three daughters are still held by the terrorists, who boast of treating Yazidi women as sex slaves. Marigold Varco is a psychiatric nurse from Australia. She works with scores of deeply traumatized Yazidi women.
Yes, you're always shocked and troubled by what you hear because of the suffering of the people. The Yazidis people have been persecuted more than anybody else, I believe, because they weren't recognized as a race, as a people. They weren't recognized within the community. And so they've been persecuted and put down more than anybody else, it seems, within the community. Many of these women, they're inspiring to know because of the courage that they show. And they try to leave behind what has happened to them and try to establish life. The sad thing is that many of the men are lost, many of the men are missing. They're killed, they've had to endure losing their partners, losing their children, their families, and many of the men feel completely responsible for this. And so the men suffer an enormous amount as well, because they are taken and taken in enforced to fight in some way, or they're killed, or otherwise they have to endure losing daughters, losing wives, managing life without their families at all, if any of them are fortunate enough to escape. So we just work with the people to try and give them some sort of physical comfort, some sort of hope, spiritual comfort, emotional comfort, and hope that they can trust that they can find hope to continue on in the future.
That was the most sobering thing that I did in the past year. I went to a lot of places. I was in Uganda and in South Sudan not very long ago about the refugee crisis there, and that in its own way is harrowing. But what these women especially, but also the men, the entire community have suffered is deeply traumatic. The woman, Murat, who I interviewed there, I've never really interviewed anybody who I could only describe as sort of a zombie. She spoke for about an hour almost without interruption in a very dark room that was lit by a single kerosene lamp. And it was quite cold in the room. It was last December, and it gets quite cold in Iraq. This was just outside of the city of Mosul, which was then under siege and about to be liberated. And she was holding in her hand a telephone, a cell telephone, and on that she had the only images of her daughters. And throughout the entire interview, she fondled and caressed and held, as if her life depended on it, that telephone. And she kept looking at her three daughters. Her daughters were, if I remember correctly, something like 6 and 8 and 10 years old. She herself had been a sex slave for 14 months, and she and her two sons were freed when her family put together $20,000. And so she was liberated. Her daughters were not, because they were of much greater value to Islamic State. And her daughters, the last that I know of, we don't know if they're alive or dead, but they were taken to Raqqa in Syria from Iraq. And as if you follow the war at all, you know Raqqa is one of the last redoubts of Islamic State. And American-backed forces and American special forces are closing on Raqqa right now. That is where, as I understand it, at least 500 Yazidi girls are still held as sex slaves at this juncture. And so that I've done a lot of things in a lot of countries, been to a lot of wars, 19 wars, and that was a very special and dark moment. The other themes that were discussed here a bit were about peacekeeping or about the United Nations, and I have a very high opinion of a couple of things that the United Nations does. The World Health Organization and the World Food Program, I think, do tremendous work in bringing relief in the field to people who are in extreme distress. But the rest of the effort is too often a total shambles. And perhaps the worst part of all of it is the peacekeeping part that Canada aspires to join. I just read the other day an unclassified report by CSIS about what is taking place in northern Mali. And we are told that the prime minister now says, we need to study this. We don't want to be rushed into a decision. Well, actually, he committed Canada to this during the election 20 months ago without thinking about it at all. And he says now Canadians need to be educated about what peacekeeping is today. I think those 20 months have been spent educating the Prime Minister about what peacekeeping is today. I think he was absolutely clueless when he made this promise, but there were surveys that Canadians thought peacekeeping was a good idea, and he thought there were votes in it during the election. The British have decided to send some peacekeepers to South Sudan. They made the decision from the get-go to committing in a matter of about 4 weeks. Canada has spent 20 months thinking about where we might go. I'm in favor of some kind of mission, but it has to be an extremely robust one. And as I understand it, it's very likely not to be a robust mission at all. In fact, it will be extremely risk adverse. And if it is that way, I'm not sure a lot of good can be done. Another theme that was discussed here quite a bit was about the Muslim attitude towards women. I lived in Afghanistan for quite a few years. I've lived in Iraq for quite a few years, and I visited just about all of these places, whether it's Yemen, which is a total mess right now, or Somalia, Eritrea. And I've had some remarkable discussions, not with Muslim women, because it's so hard to speak with them. It's just not culturally allowed, but with Muslim men about women. And I remember in Iraq driving south from Baghdad when it was still possible to drive freely there in 2004 before things got too bad. And I was with two Shia men. One was a translator and one was a driver, and we're going to the holy city of Najaf. And somehow we got to discussing women. And one of the fellas said to me, what would you do if you saw your sister speaking to a man on the street who you didn't know? And I said, well, it's a hypothetical question because I've got four brothers, but I don't have any sisters. But I suppose if I saw my sister speaking to somebody I didn't know, I might, when I next saw her that evening or next week, say, oh, by the way, who was that you were talking to? I don't know who that guy was. And they immediately, in unison practically, said to me, this proves that you don't love and respect your family. And I said, what do you exactly mean by that? And they said, well, she should never have done that. She'd committed a mortal sin. And that because it's a mortal sin, they would have murdered her for this. And this proved their love of their family and that I was out of sorts because I clearly did not love and respect my family. These kind of messages are shocking. I'm no feminist. I'm quite a right-winger on all kinds of things. But these kind of things really rock you and put you back on your heels. It's just amazing to hear such tales. And I could frankly give you 100 or 200 or 500 such experiences. Another one in Baghdad during the election, a woman who spoke very good English. I was out there with two reporters from the New York Times, and we found somebody who spoke elegant English, and she was a dentist, British-educated woman, and she started to speak to us in very general terms about the election. And out of nowhere, a man appeared beside her, who it turned out was her husband, and he told her in Arabic to shut up, and he said that he spoke for the family, and he would tell us what he thought about the election. And then he took over the whole interview, but he had nothing particularly interesting to say. And she was a very interesting, well-educated, clearly, woman, and she had no voice at all in that situation. I've seen this again and again, and I have now seen it most recently in Europe. We were out on a street. I was with a photographer in Marseille about a year and a half ago in the Arab Quarter. And the Arab Quarter is actually about one-third of the city, and it's a no-go zone where the police don't go, and nobody who looks like me would go there. And it was in the middle of the afternoon, and we had cameras with us, and a woman in a hijab came at us with a knife and was screaming in Arabic that we had no right to be there with cameras. In fact, we had no right to be in that community at all. A group of young men materialized, and they pushed her back because the last thing they wanted was guys like us getting murdered in the Arab Quarter. But they also demanded to see our cameras. And we showed them our cameras, and we had not taken any photographs of any women. And then they said we could go, but they thought it'd be a very good idea if we left entirely. About 6 or 7 weeks ago, I was in Rosendal, which is the Arab Quarter in the Swedish city of Malmo. And they have a big Arab bazaar there. This community would be about 99% Arab, and some of them are quite radicalized. And it was the middle of the afternoon, and I stopped two youngish women, they 16, 18 years old, to simply ask them where the bazaar was, because I was a little bit lost and I wanted to get oriented. And they had not uttered more than two or three sentences before a man appeared. Ironically, he was a dentistry student, somebody else in dentistry, and he shouted at them in Arabic, and they disappeared. And he said that I had no right to be speaking to his sister, as it turned out. And he said, you white people are all pedophiles, and you are trying to get at my sister. And it's 2 o'clock in the afternoon on an avenue with hundreds of people. I don't know much about how pedophiles operate, but my experience is that they don't approach women with 200 people around in the middle of the afternoon. I suspect that's not the way they operate. But then he immediately got in it with America has bombed and murdered so many people in the Middle East. And he told me the green flag of Islam will one day wave over all of Sweden. That was his message. And the strains in Swedish society today, we operate in a bit of a vacuum here in Canada. It's just amazing. I'm not against Canada taking in Muslims at all or taking in people from anywhere. I wish we would take in more Christians from some of these areas rather than just taking in Muslims. This is something I just don't get. My friend Patrick Gill, I've helped put his daughters through school. He's a Church of Pakistan, which is actually an Episcopalian or Church of England derivative, but 2 million people in Pakistan are Christians. And his daughters go to school every day in an armored bus. And there are armed guards on the bus, and the bus it has screens on the window. The bus gets stoned. Well, the little girls, 6 and 8 years old, the Christian girls go off to school every day. And Patrick cannot get any consideration from Canada in terms of coming here beyond the normal immigration procedures. And yet we've taken so many people, I think, without really thinking all of this through. The other thing is, I get sick of how sanctimonious Canadians are about this whole question of us being the best. We have now all these kind of slogans, the world needs more Canada. Canada took in 40,000 refugees. Sweden took in 123,000. Sweden's population is 12 and a half or 13 million people, which means there's a tremendous difference. Also, their economy, even per capita, is a little bit smaller. The Swedish prime minister, as far as I know, no Swedish politician has boasted about how great this is, certainly has not appeared in selfies or flown to airports to be photographed with all the refugees that come. But Canada just keeps patting itself on the back all the time about how good we are. And I go out in the world, and frankly, Canada doesn't cut that big a figure out there. Am I already out of time? Because I've got 2 minutes? Okay. I didn't understand the thing. I did have uplifting things I wanted to talk about today because this is kind of a downer. I did want to talk about, and I hope I get perhaps invited back again sometime because I wanted to talk about how people go to the bathroom in war zones, soldiers and whatnot, because I think it's very interesting. Movies are so antiseptic and you don't really get a feel for any of that. I also wanted to talk about the refugee crisis in Uganda with people coming down from South Sudan, because Canada boasts about 40,000. Uganda has taken in 1 million, and they've taken them in within 9 months, and of course they have no resources, and the funding from the UN and international organizations is 15% of what is required. And now Uganda is starting to think about whether they can really support this. 3.5 million people out of the 12 million people in South Sudan are refugees. Another million live in other countries that border South Sudan, and then the rest of them are internally displaced within South Sudan. It is an absolutely catastrophic situation, and it makes no impression in Canada at all. We've been so focused on how great we have been to the Syrian people. And as I say, I'm not against that. But if you are going to be so sanctimonious, if you are going to take great credit for all these things, then you have to be more magnanimous than that. You have to do even more for people. Anyway, that's what I do. I just came out of Latvia, where Canadian forces are, and Eastern Ukraine, where the war is still going on. And I was with the Prime Minister at the G7 in Belgium and in Italy. I could talk about him a bit, but I won't. And I am on my way now to the East China Sea next week, and I'll be on warships out there in waters that are disputed between China, South Korea, and Japan. This is north of the South China Sea, where there are seven countries claiming the same water, and it's becoming a Chinese lake, where before it was an American lake. So I keep going, but last year I talked about me being extinct, sort of the last of a species in Canada. The New York Times, Washington Post, those guys are going to continue. But in Canada, the number of foreign correspondents is dropping to zero, like a stone. We're just disappearing. I'm waiting for the extinction event. I thought I'd be gone by this year. It hasn't happened because, of course, newspapers are in crisis. But I hope that I continue to do this for a while yet. I've done it a very long time. I've been abroad for 34 years, and this is pretty much all that I've done for all of those years, to go to these kind of places. And I think it's important that people still are willing to go out there. That's really about all I've got to say. I've overstayed my welcome, but thank you very much. And as I could say to you, Moses, Shabbat Shalom.
Matthew. And yes, you can come back next year. The continuing adventures of Matthew Fisher.
Let me tell a few jokes next year.
Yeah? He wants to tell jokes next year.
This is good.
I wanted to tell him about bathrooms.
All eyes on me. Here we go.
How long do you take?
Thank you.
2 minutes for the first one.
Thank
you.
Yeah?
So I can give it.
He wants 2 minutes to tell you about bathrooms.
Or lack of them. There are two little stories. The first one, we get to Tikrit, which is Saddam Hussein's hometown. I'm with the United States Marine Corps, Marine Recon, which are the really big guys. We get there, and all the guys are going in to look at the chandeliers and try to find the golden rifles and all that. I want to go to the bathroom because I've been in the field 37 days and haven't seen a toilet. I go in, and I find a golden toilet. It's solid gold, top to bottom. I haven't gone to the bathroom for 37 days. It's in perfect working order. And I sit down, and it is magnificent. I return 24 hours later, and everybody else has discovered it, but it doesn't flush. And you just don't want to go anywhere near it. And the last thing I want to say is the Marine Corps, they have shit circles at night where all the guys sit in a circle after the day's events in their vehicles, and they gossip between the vehicles, and they have little trowels to dig stuff out afterwards. But they just gossip, and literally all of them in this wonderful circle. But then when they get up and talk, if you have not bathed for 37 days, there's this elegant dance that takes place because you always want to be upwind of the person beside you. And so as soon as you catch a whiff of somebody, you move a step. And then they are going to move a step. And so literally, if you watch 6 or 8 Marines at a distance of 10 or 20 meters, you will see that everybody is just slowly moving around, trying to get out of the stench zone of the other person. And these are the real realities of war. I watched Generation Zero and all these things, and nobody ever goes to the bathroom. And I can tell you, if you haven't gone for a week because you've been encased in an armored vehicle, you really want to go. I know. Thank you.
Exactly.
Okay. Thank you.